I wrote the Maples Lament at a time when I had bought Bob Scovel's violin shop and moved it and opened it under, you know, I was running the shop at that point, and didn't have a big advertising budget, so it's like nobody knew there was a violin shop there. Nobody showed up. I had a lot of free time on my hands and a lot of fiddles to look at. So I was just sitting there, and I, you know, there's an inscription that used to be written in Latin in a lot of violins. I think it was in the Victorian era, maybe, that roughly translated says something like, "When I was alive, I stood mute in the forest. Now, in death, I sing." And, you know, I think I was just sitting there kind of thinking about that, and I thought, I'll bet that's not how the tree feels about it. You know, because, I mean, I'm a big tree hugger. And I just, the idea of it, of the song came to me, and I just started writing it down, or maybe I didn't even write it down. I just sang the words over and over until I memorized it. And I closed up the shop. I drove home singing the song the whole way. And I got home, and there's a friend of mine visiting from out of town. And I said, "Hey, Ray, I made up this song. Listen." And this guy said, he's a big guy. He's like 6'4" or something like that. Great big, tall guy. And I sang it for him, and he started crying. And I go, "All right, I got it. It's a good song." But it was just sort of, I think, to set the record straight in my mind, you know, to have a different point of view than the anthropomorphic point of view of, the tree's destiny is to become a violin that somebody plays. But the tree would much rather be a tree.
Your decision to record it using the hardanger?
Mm-hmm.
Tell me a little about that.
I first just sang the song a cappella, and I think it was my friend Beth Weil that said, "You should accompany yourself on the fiddle on that song." And so I practiced playing the fiddle along and singing it at the same time. But I got very, very lucky, and I had bought a hardanger fiddle, a Norwegian hardingfele, which has four strings on top that you play, but it also has five sympathetic strings that run under the fingerboard and through the middle of the bridge, and they just resonate sort of like a sitar when you're bowing it. So I thought, well, I'll try it on the hardanger fiddle. And it really was a magic feeling to have just those ringing tones. And it made it a lot easier, actually, to sing and play in tune with all those overtones ringing at the same time. So it was kind of a leg up, in fact. So when I decided to record it, it was obvious that I was going to record it with the hardanger fiddle. It's still much easier to play on the hardanger than it is on a regular fiddle, because the hardanger is so much less strident. It's so sort of forgiving when you play it. And a regular fiddle, even if I tune up the G string to an A, so it's got more sort of ring to it, and I play it in A. But even so, it's a little more to wrestle with under your chin and to sing against than the hardanger fiddle.
And your own ancestry.
That's right. I'm half Norwegian, so that, in fact, that's why I ended up with this fiddle. I used to play at this bar called Paul's Saloon in San Francisco, and right next door to it was a music store called The Fifth String, and a Dane by the name of Richard Kelson ran The Fifth String music store, and he used to tease me about being Norwegian because, you know, and he would call me a Swede, you know, which is, I don't know, it was just a sort of a ribbing that he and I always went through. And one day, I won a fiddle contest up in Cloverdale in Northern California, and I won $300. And when I got home, there was a phone message from Richard, and he said, "Hey, I have something I think you might like at this shop. Come on in when you have a chance." So I went in the next day, and he said, "This guy came in the other day, and he told me he had a humdinger." and he said, of course, I knew immediately what it was, and I bought it from him. So now I have it, and I'll sell it to you if you want it. I said, "How much is it?" He said, "Well, how much do you want to pay?" I go, $300, because I had just won $300. And he goes, "Okay." And I've always wondered if I had said 150, if he would have said okay or whatever. But there went my prize money, and I came home with a hardingfele made in 1921 in Bergen, Norway. Lovely fiddle.
You'd have forgotten that $300 a lot quicker than that.
Yeah, that's right.
You still have it?
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay. I definitely have it. I don't travel with it. I have too many other things to travel with, you know, too many other instruments, a guitar and a fiddle and sometimes a banjo, and so I don't really take it out. But every once in a while, I take it out and play it.
Thank you.
Sometimes from my memories I can sing the birds in flight. And I can sing of sweet dark earth and endless starry nights. But oh, my favorite song of all, I truly do believe, is the song the sunlight sang to me while dancing